Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, Anna Mateo and Andrew Smith present the Health and Lifestyle Report. They tell about the benefits of a form of exercise called resistance training. We close the show with the lesson of the day. But first, this report.
Officials are investigating how a gunman was able to fire several shots at former President Donald Trump during a campaign event in Butler, Pennsylvania, on Saturday. Trump said one bullet struck his right ear. One person at the gathering was killed in the attack. Two others were wounded and remain hospitalized. Officials say the gunman was 20-year-old Thomas Matthew Crooks. Security shot and killed Crooks, who was on top of a nearby building. Trump is expected to receive the Republican presidential nomination at the party's national convention in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, this week. Political violence, like the attack against Trump, is considered rare in the United States. But Saturday's attempted political killing, or assassination, and history show that presidents and presidential candidates can be the targets of dangerous or deadly attacks. Here are some attacks listed by the Associated Press.
Abraham Lincoln was the 16th president and the first to be killed in office. John Wilkes Booth, an actor, shot Lincoln in the head while he sat with his wife, Mary Todd Lincoln, as they watched a play at Ford's Theater in Washington, D.C. Lincoln was taken to a nearby house where he died of his wound the next morning. The assassination took place on April 14, 1865, days after the South's surrender, ending the U.S. Civil War. Booth was killed on April 26th near Bowling Green, Virginia.
James Garfield was the second president to be assassinated. Charles Guiteau shot Garfield as he walked through a train station in Washington on July 2, 1881. Efforts to find the bullet in Garfield's chest were unsuccessful. Garfield was moved to the New Jersey coast, where he died on September 6th, after only 6 months in office. Guiteau was tried, found guilty, and executed in June 1882.
William McKinley, the 25th president, was shot twice in the chest after giving a speech in Buffalo, New York, on September 6, 1901. Although doctors expected him to recover, a gangrene infection set in. He died on September 14th. 28-year-old Leon Czolgosz admitted to the shooting. He was tried, found guilty, and electrocuted in October of the same year.
The 35th president, John F. Kennedy, was shot in Dallas, Texas, on November 22, 1963, while traveling in an open car. He died soon afterward at Parkland Memorial Hospital. Police soon arrested Lee Harvey Oswald after finding evidence in a nearby building, the Texas School Book Depository. 2 days later, Jack Ruby, a nightclub owner, shot Oswald, who died. The shooting took place as Oswald was being taken from police headquarters in Dallas in front of television cameras. There have been several other attacks on presidents and presidential candidates. Here is a short list. Theodore Roosevelt, the 26th president, was shot in Milwaukee in 1912 while campaigning as a third-party candidate. Roosevelt was seeking a third term. Folded papers and a metal container apparently slowed the bullet, and he was not seriously hurt. His would-be assassin was arrested and spent the rest of his life in mental hospitals.
Gerald Ford served as the nation's 38th president. He faced two attempted assassinations within weeks in 1975. The first was by a follower of Charles Manson, Lynette Fromm. She pushed through a crowd in Sacramento, California, but did not fire her weapon. Fromm was sentenced to prison and released in 2009. 17 days later, another woman, Sarah Jane Moore, fired at Ford and missed in San Francisco. She was released from prison in 2007.
The 40th president, Ronald Reagan, was walking to his car after a speech in Washington when he was shot by John Hinckley Jr. Reagan recovered from the March 1981 shooting. Three others were shot, including his press secretary, James Brady. Brady would be partially paralyzed for the rest of his life. Hinckley was arrested. A jury found him not guilty because he was mentally sick. He was sent to a mental hospital instead. Hinckley was released in 2022 after a judge said he was no longer a danger to himself or others.
Robert Kennedy, brother of John Kennedy and a senator from New York, was seeking the Democratic Party's presidential nomination in June 1968. He had just won the Democratic primary election in California. After a victory speech at a hotel in Los Angeles, Sirhan Sirhan shot and killed Kennedy and wounded five other people. Sirhan was found guilty and was sentenced to death. His sentence was commuted to life in prison, where he remains.
Alabama Governor George Wallace was seeking the Democratic presidential nomination when he was shot during a campaign stop in Maryland in 1972. The shooting left him paralyzed from the waist down. Arthur Bremer was convicted in the shooting and sentenced to prison. He was released in 2007. I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
And I'm Katie Weaver.
From VOA Learning English, this is the Health and Lifestyle Report. Some experts suggest that lifting weights is the best way to keep our bodies strong and healthy as we age. Weightlifting is a type of resistance training. Penn State University College of Medicine experts define resistance training as a type of exercise that causes your muscles to work against an outside resistance. Some experts claim resistance training can even slow aging. Marcus Bauman has researched the effects of weight resistance training on aging bodies for many years. He shared his advice recently with the Associated Press. Resistance training is in many ways the true fountain of youth, Bauman said. Our bodies do have biological limits, but Bauman said older people put too few demands on their bodies, not too many. He said that most age-related loss of strength, flexibility, and endurance comes from the lack of physical demands on our bodies, such as exercise. Bauman said that strength training for several months can increase muscle mass and ability to the level of people 30 to 35 years younger. He added that a lot of people are interested in that message.
Bauman's advice is mainly for people 60 years of age or older. However, he said no one should wait to start resistance training. He also suggests going to a gym to work out with weight machines. For beginners, he said machines are better. However, experts at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention say you do not need weight machines to do strength training. You can strengthen your muscles by using free weights, such as barbells or dumbbells, and resistance bands. You can also use your own body weight, for example, by doing push-ups or similar exercises. Before starting any resistance training, experts suggest getting the advice of a medical doctor. For those using a gym with weight machines, Bauman also suggests getting a trainer, a person to teach you how to use the equipment. It's actually quite safe, he said. But he added that a good trainer can teach the movements properly.
You can go to a gym, do training at home, or work out in a park. However, both Bauman and the CDC suggest doing resistance training twice a week. Bauman added that three times a week is even better. He also suggests non-weight training days in between. For example, if you strength train on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, then you should rest on Tuesday and Thursday. He said before resistance training, start with 5 to 10 minutes of light activity and stretching to warm up. Then do between 8 and 10 different resistance exercise movements. Repeat each movement 10 times. Do these sets of 10 repetitions 3 times. Then move on to the next movement. When you reach the 10th repetition, you should feel you cannot do many more. If you could have done 10 more, you might want to increase the resistance. Bauman also suggests that people should keep moving during their training. Sometimes you see people who sit on the machine, do a set, and then play with their phone for 3 to 4 minutes, he observed. Bauman said strength training is important for both men and women. However, he said women might gain even more from resistance training than men. Resistance training is a way to prevent osteoporosis, the loss of bone density. Bauman said that over time, women face an increased risk of bone loss. They can develop problems in their hips and lower back. Yasuko Kuroi is 72 and started resistance training about 20 years ago. She spoke to the AP at a public recreation center in Tokyo. She said, "I saw the men in the gym and I thought, I could do that too."
Experts at Stanford University say research shows that between the ages of 20 and 80, we can lose between 35% and 40% of our muscle mass. There is a popular English expression that can relate to the body's muscle mass. Use it or lose it. Bauman says we are too easy on our bodies. He criticized healthcare professionals who are too easy on older people. Our human body is a demand-based system, he explained. He added that if you continuously put low demands on your body will adapt to that low demand. That's why we lose muscle mass. That's why we get weaker. We're not demanding much, Bauman said. However, if you put higher demands on your body with such activities as resistance training, your body has to adapt to these higher demands. The body adapts by making stronger bones and bigger muscles. Bauman used the example of spaceflight, or extended bed rest. In these situations, people quickly lose strength. All of our systems, as we age, are capable of responding and adapting. They just need the stimulus. He said he has seen positive effects for people in their 70s and 80s, and even for some in their 90s.
Bauman, 57, joked that he is now closer in age to the people who he studies. But he warned that there are no shortcuts. He criticized some programs for older adults that use only seated exercises. He said these do not put enough demands on the body. And that's the Health and Lifestyle Report. I'm Anna Mateo.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
Anna Mateo joins me now to talk more about this week's Health and Lifestyle Report. Hi, Anna.
Hi, and thanks for having me on your show.
Your report this week talks about resistance training as we age. One of the experts described one kind of resistance training, weightlifting, as the fountain of youth. What does he mean by that?
The expert, Marcus Bauman, calls weightlifting the fountain of youth because he says he believes this type of exercise can keep us feeling young.
Is weightlifting the only kind of resistance training that gives us this benefit?
I'm glad you asked that question. Bauman specifically talks about going to the gym to use weight machines. He claims that this is the best way for beginners. However, many people do not have access to a gym or weight machines. So other experts say you can use free weights, resistance bands, or just your own weight.
using your own weight as resistance would be things like push-ups or plank poses. Is that right?
That's correct. And people can do those types of resistance exercises anywhere, and they are free to do. Some gyms can cost a lot.
That's a good point. Well, thanks so much for speaking with me today, Anna, and thank you for that report.
Thanks for having me. It's always a pleasure.
And now it's time for the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. My name is Andrew Smith, and I'm joined by Dr. Jill Robbins. Hi, Jill.
Hi, Andrew.
Our lesson is based on our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Anna introducing herself.
Hello, my name is Anna Mateo.
In today's lesson, we're going to talk about a quick and easy way to connect two sentences. To do this, we're going to listen to Lesson 14 from Level 2 of the video series. In Lesson 14, Anna's friend Pete talks about his girlfriend, and Ashley talks about her boyfriend. Both of them say they have found the perfect partner.
Hello! What are you guys looking at?
I'm showing Ashley pictures of my girlfriend. We have so much in common, even small things. She can't whistle, and I can't either.
And here's a picture of my boyfriend. My family is big, and so is his. I don't like ball sports, and he doesn't either. We are made for each other.
And so are we.
And here is what whistling is. Okay, now that you know what whistling is, let's go back to connecting sentences. We could hear some ways to connect sentences in these examples.
She can't whistle, and I can't either.
My family is big, and so is his. I don't like ball sports, and he doesn't either. We are made for each other.
And so are we.
And now let's listen to Professor Bott explain the way Pete and Ashley connected their sentences.
Pete and Ashley are talking about people they love. They are putting two ideas together with connectors. Let's start with these two sentences. She can't whistle. Pete can't whistle. How do you put them together? Pete says,
she can't whistle, and I can't either.
You can see we just add the conjunction either and take away the verb whistle. And Ashley says,
I don't like ball sports, and he doesn't either.
For statements with a negation, which use the word not, instead of repeating the main verb, at the end of the sentence, we add the word either. That usually makes the sentence shorter.
Right. Compare these two sentences.
I don't like ball sports, and he doesn't like ball sports.
I don't like ball sports, and he doesn't either.
By using the word either, Ashley did not have to repeat the phrase, he doesn't like ball sports.
You may have just noticed, we pronounce that connector in two ways, and both ways have the same meaning. We can pronounce it either or either.
You say either, and I say either. There's a famous American song that uses this difference in pronunciation in its lyrics. The name of the song is Let's Call the Whole Thing Off.
In the song, a man and woman want to call off, which means end or cancel their relationship because they always disagree about certain things.
But Pete and Ashley don't want to call off their relationships. When they talk about their partners, they say,
"We are made for each other.
And so are we."
The expression, "to be made for each other," means to be almost perfectly matched to live happily with another person.
But what about Anna? She doesn't have a boyfriend. But she lies to Pete and Ashley, telling them she does have a boyfriend. But they know she's lying.
And that's why, a little later, Anna says she is sorry. And then she explains that she has found her own perfect match, too. Let's listen.
"I'm sorry, but later, I really did meet someone. And we have a lot in common.
He's good at flying kites, and so am I. He likes to read comics, and so do I. I can play the ukulele, and so can he."
"He sounds perfect for you, Anna. Can he come tonight?"
"That's the sad part. You see, he just got a job as a spy. And tonight, he leaves on assignment."
"Of course he does."
"But that's okay. Because now I know that there is someone out there made for me. Oh, it's late. I have to see him off at the train station. Bye, you guys."
"Bye, Anna." "Oh, dear. She's worse than we thought."
"She's lost her mind."
"What should we do?"
"Let's tell her."
"No, Pete. Mr. Wright may not be real, but he makes her really happy."
It looks like Anna's boyfriend is only in her imagination instead of a real person. Notice how, instead of repeating the same verb twice, she connected her sentences like this.
"He's good at flying kites, and so am I. He likes to read comics, and so do I. I can play the ukulele, and so can he."
For an action verb, we connect with the auxiliary verb do.
"He likes to read comics, and so do I."
For the verb be, we connect with a form of the verb be. In this example, Anna connects "he's good" with "so am I."
"He's good at flying kites, and so am I."
And with the modal can, we just repeat the modal, like this.
"I can play the ukulele, and so can he."
It does seem like Anna has a lot in common with her imaginary boyfriend, Mr. Wright. I suppose a lot of people try to imagine a perfect partner they could spend time with.
And if they're lucky, that imaginary person becomes real when they find the right person.
And we hope the lesson of the day is a good match for you. Remember that you can email us and ask us your questions about English. If you're lucky, we'll try to answer them in another lesson of the day.
You can send your email to learningenglish@voanews.com.
Remember, you can also find us on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram. Thanks for listening. I'm Dr. Jill.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.